I'm delighted to welcome you to the panel. I'm sure that we will have some brilliant presentations. It's a great team of panelists that we have on my left and on my right. And before I introduce the panelists, I will contextualize the panel a little bit. I'll do it by briefly outlining three observations that I think are relevant and important for what we are going to discuss. The first observation takes its point of departure in a book that was published many years ago about Dutch foreign policy. And I keep remembering the title. I think it's a great title. It is Peace, Profits, and Principles. It's on Dutch foreign policy, but it seems to me also to be applicable to European foreign policy or to the foreign policy of the European Union. And it is applicable, it seems to me, in the following fashion. First of all, a title like that emphasizes that foreign policy almost always have multiple objectives. And moreover, that these objectives are not always mutually supportive. That is probably also some of the hard choices that foreign policy makers and decision makers have to make. The title also suggests that different stakeholders in society and in the life of politics promote different foreign policy objectives and instruments as well. And finally, the title suggests that foreign policy objectives and instruments are essentially contested, and basically this is the politics, this is what the politics of foreign policy is all about. The endless ongoing discussion about setting the direction of a foreign policy actor, whether it is the Netherlands, it is the European Union, or any other actor in foreign affairs. And I think this title and these contradictions and clashes between different objectives is something that for sure we will be discussing when we come to the panel on European Union and liberal peacemaking. The second observation I would like to make is that liberal internationalism is only one of four or five major foreign policy schools of thinking that are competing nationally and transnationally with each other. What does this imply? It implies that whatever a liberal internationalist is doing or arguing or achieving, you can rest assured that he or she will be criticized by representatives of the other foreign policy schools of thinking. So there's an ongoing discussion going on, and the liberal internationalist is just one out of several. For example, for national isolationists, the European Union itself is one internationalist step too far, for which reason they object to whatever takes place at the European level, in Brussels, and so on. For a European isolationist, the idea is that Europeans should simply cultivate their own garden and not engage in the world. And if something should be done, then it is to shield Europe from all these external threats that appears from time to time. So in other words, more Frontex and less EEIS, the External Action Service in Brussels. The third observation I would like to make is that the politics of European foreign policy is played out on a daily basis and exercised by journalists, politicians, academics, and others. Take a very recent example, the Wall Street Journal, Saturday, 2 days ago. Well, there was an article about the future, the possible future direction of European foreign policy. And basically, the message in that article was that for some time, the European Union has been promoting democracy and human rights, but now the European Union is growing up and replacing the promotion of democracy and human rights with what has been defined as strategic interests. And one of the examples of strategic interest is given, namely stability. So different politicians, academics, and the journalists putting it all together made this contradiction between promoting democracy and human rights and trying to achieve or defend European strategic interests. And this is just one example out of many. So it is ongoing, this discussion, and you see examples of it time and again. Now, of course, in this panel, we will not be analyzing foreign policy doctrines like liberal internationalism. We will not be discussing or analyzing strategic objectives or the European Union's international identity. The panel is on the operational aspects of liberal peacekeeping. However, it seems to me that there is a bridge between the doctrine, liberal internationalism, and our more specialized topic, namely liberal peacebuilding. And the word liberal, you see, is the overlapping term. It suggests that not all peacekeeping is liberal in its orientation. There are other means, not necessarily promoted by the European Union, but by other actors. Russia was mentioned in the keynote speech, and of course there is peace in South Ossetia, but it's not necessarily a liberal peacemaking that was used to introduce that peace in South Ossetia. Moreover, if a doctrine such as liberal internationalism is not fleshed out in concrete policies, and if concrete policies are not accompanied by administrative programs, then the doctrine does not really matter, except as a topic for what we could call armchair politics. Now, for the analysis of these operational aspects of liberal peacebuilding, we have a very strong team, as I mentioned at the beginning. A very strong team of panelists consisting of, and here I, on my far left, Roger McGinty from the University of Manchester. On my right, Peter Faith, who is a former EU Special Representative in Kosovo. And on my immediate left, Stephanie Kapler from Durham University. Now, of course, I could spend a really long time introducing all the accomplishments in terms of analysis and study. But I will not, because the reason they are here is that they have a very long pedigree of accomplishments in this field. And that is why I'm very much looking forward to hear what they can inform us about liberal peacebuilding in very concrete cases.